Okay, so let's start. So we have start with Ourison metrization theorem. So X normal if X is normal with a countable basis, the second countable, right? Countable basis implies X metrizable. So it's stronger with regular, okay? Yeah, regular is okay, but we prove this. A regular space which is with a countable basis is normal. But that I will not prove. So proof. Lemma. There is a countable collection of continuous functions. Fn from x to 0, 1 to the interval 0, 1. So n in n, countable, such that given any point x in x and neighborhood u of x, given any point and every neighborhood of that point, there is an index n such that Fn. So it's x0, well, given any point x0 in x and any neighborhood u of x0, there is an index n such that fn of x0 is bigger than 0 and fn of the complement of the neighborhood is 0. This is an important lemma, okay? So the rest is easy. Okay, proof. This is Ourison lemma. Proof of the lemma. So we have a countable basis, okay? So let B be a countable basis. For X, second countable. For each pair of indices, A, B, so sorry, for B equal BN. N in N. So this is also countable. B a countable basis for X, BN. For each pair of indices, let's say NM, such that, so we have this BN, this is our basis. Such that the closure of Bn is contained in Bm. Vas-y, ouvre sur les mains. Så vi place ouvre sur les mains. Choose. A continuous function. FNM. So it depends on these two indices. FNM. This is not F. This will. It's not the same n. Okay. Then we. This is countable also in two indices. So no problem. FNM. Choose. Choose a continuous function such that. So horizon, you can separate closed disjoint sets, okay? One is Bn, closure, such that Gnm of the closure of B is equal to 1. So it's 1 on this. And the other closed set is the complement of Bm, the complement of Bm, and Gnm of the complement of x minus Bm is 0. So this is the lemma of Ohr's, okay? You can separate disjoint closed subsets, okay?
The function is F, not W.
Yeah, you're right. No, it's G. Okay? So I call it G now, so. But these are all Fs, of course, but in another order. So this is a countable collection of continuous functions, okay? Which depends on two indices, G and M. This is countable, okay? And now we need this property. There is an index. For any neighborhood, there is one of these functions with this property, okay? So this is a property. So let's see. Let x0, so what is the notation? X0 in U, any neighborhood U of x0, so let the x0, so consider now x0 and the neighborhood U as in the lemma. So there is a basis element which contains x0 as a contained in U, obviously. So there is choose a basis element Bm such that. Such that x0 is in Bm contained in U. So this is the basis, no problem. Yes, thank you. So now we have this situation. And we choose, obviously, a basis element, Bm, such that Bm x is contained in U. But x is regular, okay, normal. X is normal. Regular is sufficient here also. What does it say? Well, maybe it's regular is better here. Because normal is for closed subsets, regular is for a point, okay? So regular. Anyway, it's normal, but it's maybe better to write regular. So given a point and a neighborhood, so this is a lemma now, which we proved, not well, I made by picture, okay? If you have a neighborhood of a point, then there's a smaller neighborhood, such as the closure is still contained in the and given a neighborhood of a point, there's a smaller neighborhood of the point, such that the closure is still contained in the larger neighborhood. So we have the smaller neighborhood. The smaller neighborhood obviously contains again a basis element, still smaller, okay? Because it's a basis. Okay, so there is x regular, there is bn, a basis element bn in our basis such that x0 is in bn closure still, and this is contained in bn. And then, of course, gnm has what we want. So this implies that gnm where's our gnm? It's bigger than 0. gnm of bn bar is 1. And gnm of x minus bm is 0. So x minus u is 0, okay? So this proves the lemma, right? So now we have g and m in two indices, but it's countable, and now we call it fn in one index, okay? This is the lemma. And now the proof of the theorem. So the idea is, I didn't say that, but the idea is the following. So we define a function f, continuous function f, from x. We have to prove x is metrizable, okay? And so we embed it into R omega. And this has a product topology for the moment. Product topology. Well, also it works with the uniform. But let's take the product topology. So how do we find f of x is equal to? So we have this countable collection of functions, fn, okay? So you take these functions, f1 of x, f2 of x, and so on. So it's fn of x, n in n. This is a definition, f, okay? And now we want to prove that this function is an embedding. Okay, the claim is f is an embedding. What is embedding? Well, we will see in the proof. It's a homeomorphism onto its image. Okay, homeomorphism onto its image. Embedding. Homeomorphism onto its image. That's an embedding. And then, of course, that's nice, no? Because if an embedding, homeomorphism, what does it imply? This implies that X is homeomorphic, homeomorphism, to what? To its image, F of X. And what is this? It's a subspace of A. No. Subspace of what? Of R omega. R omega is metrizable. Okay? This is metrizable. I gave the metric, okay? The theorem and what is the right metric for R omega with the product topology. So R omega is metrizable. So this implies any subspace is metrizable. Subspace of metrizable space is metrizable, okay? So, subspace of a metrizable space is metrizable. It's the same metric. And this implies X is metrizable, okay? F of X. That's the idea here. This is the idea, okay? This embedding. F of x is metrizable. So we embed it into R omega. So this is a proof. So I have to prove that F is an embedding, right? Also, the uniform topology would be okay, right? Because this is a metric space even, okay? Defined by a metric, okay? So it works also with some modification. But here we take the product topology. So I have to prove this claim. F is an embedding, okay? Then we are done. Okay? This is the idea here. We construct enough continuous functions to the real numbers, and then we take all these countable number, okay? Uncountable R omega, R uncountable is no longer with the product topology, no? The uniform topology is in all, okay? So, well, anyway. So this is, now I have to prove only this claim, okay? Well, what means embedding? Homeomorphism. So, proof of the claim. So, embedding homeomorphism. So, it's injective, okay? F is injective. So, that's the first. F is injective. That means if you have two different points, then you should find some one of these functions which has different values in different points. So let x, y be different points. How are they called? Whatever. X and y, yes. Let x, y be in x, x. Different from y. So x is t1, t2, okay? X is t1. As before, x is t1. What does it mean? There's a neighborhood u of x. Which does not contain y, the other one, okay? Now we do the same game as before. We find two indices, n and m, such that, as before, what I did in the lemma, okay, as before, as before what? There are bn, bm in our basis, such that x, what is our point? X0 before, now x is contained in, no, I forget, bn closure contained in bm, or what did I write? Bn closure, yes, bn closure contained in bm. Okay? That's as before with x0, exactly the same. There are bn, bm. So there is a fn, and then we have our gnm, okay? So gnm, so what was fn? This is some fl, some, I don't know which one. Fn m of x in bn closure, what was it? It's 1, I think, no? And gnm of y. But y is in the complement of bm, okay? So it's 0. So this function is 1 here and 0 on the complement of bm. That's the Urizon lemma, right? These are the two disjoint closed sets. This is 1 here, and the other one is the complement of bm, and that's 0. So gnmx is 0. So for some fn, this happens, okay? And this means that f of x is different from f of y, because this is, these are all these GNMs. So it's injective. The second is, it's continuous. Well, this is easy, no? F is continuous. Since, why? Why it's continuous? What? All component functions are continuous. This is a product topology, okay? Since all component functions coordinate functions, whatever, Fn are continuous. And here in the if we take the uniform topology, we have to prove something still, okay? Because this is a larger topology, you know? So continuity is stronger, okay? But for the product topology, no problem. And then the last thing is that F is a, so what is the notation? F is a homeomorphism onto its image. Homeomorphism onto its image. So we have to prove that F is a homeomorphism onto its image. So what remains to prove here? It remains to prove onto its image, which I call Z. That's the image of F of X. So this is a subspace of R omega, the image. Okay? we prove that for each open set, which is called U in X, F of U, open, okay, open. It's open. So for each open set U in X, F of U is open. The image of open set is open, where in Z, not maybe in F, in X. That I don't know. In R omega, okay. In the image, we are restricting to the image. It's open in Z, which is the image. That's important. So that we have to prove, right? Okay. That's the last point. So we have to prove that for each open set, Fu is open in... So take any point here in F of U, okay? Let, which is called Z, whatever it is called, Z0 in F of U. F of U is open here. So we have a point here now. We have to find an open set in Z which contains this point and is contained in Z, okay? The usual thing, open, okay? Open means for every point, we find an open set which contains a point, is contained in our set, which we want to prove open. So let 0 be in F of U. So let x0 be in U, so it's an image, f of something, such that f of x0 is z0. It's an f of U anyway, okay? So we take a pre-image in U. Now, we have this point x0, okay? And we have our collection of functions. And we have a neighborhood of U. So what was the lemma? For each point, each neighborhood, we find an index n such that fn is bigger than 0 in the point and 0 in the complement of this function. That's the main point, no? So choose an index n such that fn, gnm, g something, gn, fn of x0 is bigger than 0, 1, it was 1, but bigger than 0, okay? And in the complement of u, fn of x minus u, it is 0. Again, the lemma, okay? The lemma. So we apply again the lemma. So let V, by definition, V is a pre-image of, so pi n, what is pi n? That's a projection on the nth coordinate of r omega, okay? Projection onto the nth coordinate, as usual, of r omega. So one here, not one of these. Projection of the nth complement, pi n minus 1 of the interval 0 infinity. So we avoid 0. Okay, we take this. So this is open. Open. Where is it open? In X for the moment, okay? Pre-image of an open set. But that means, of course, that W, which I'm not interested in X, I'm in, open in X, yeah. I'm not interesting so this is V intersection Z. There are too many notions here. V, Z. So V is this pre-image and Z is the image now, okay? Sorry, I wrote something wrong. Now open in where? R omega. Okay. I was something was not okay, but I didn't. So this is a projection from R omega onto its nth coordinate, okay? So this is open in R omega. But we are not interested in R omega, okay? We are interested in the image. And so I intersect now with the image, okay? So this is open in Z now, clearly. This is open in Z, this is the image of f of x. So this is in R omega. We are in R omega. Okay? And now this is the set which we... so the claim now is, again, well, one claim after the other. That's okay. This is our set. So claim again. What is our point? Our point is called where is it? Z zero. Okay. This is the point we choose in the image. So the claim is x0 is contained in W. This is open, no? This is open in, that's open in Z, in f of x. And this is contained in, where it should be contained, what is it called? F of u. And then we are done. So this implies f of u is open in z, which is f of x, no? Then we are done, okay? So Z0 is in W since, so this is immediate, since pi n of x0 of Z0, this projection, what is this? This is pi n of f of x0 and this is fn of x0, so this is bigger than 0, yes. Pi n of z0 is bigger than 0, so we are here, okay? So this is okay, and second, so what remains is W is contained in F of U. So take a point in W. Let Z be in W. Then Z is equal to f of x for some x in x. We are in f of x, okay? But f of x is not sufficient. We need f of u for some x in x. And pi n of z is where? In 0, infinity. Z is in W. There are many notions, too many notions. Now W, you always have a new name for everything, no? But that's from the book. So this is the image, okay? We are in the image anyway of X, and now we are also in V, the positive coordinate. Now we have these two things here. Okay. Since, no, pi n of z is equal to what? Is pi n of f of x. No, f of x is z, anyway. And this is f n of x. And f n vanishes, is 0. F n is vanishes outside. Where does it vanish? Outside U. This was our neighborhood. This means that X has to be in where? In U. F of N vanishes outside U, no? But f n of x, so this is bigger than 0, sorry, okay? I might better add that. So pi n of z is this, is f f of x bigger than 0, okay? This is bigger than 0 because we are in the in V here, in the pre-image of avoidance 0. And where n is also, so this means x is in, U. It has to be in U. Because Fn vanishes outside U. So we have to be in U. And this means that F of Z, Z, what is that? Z, which is F of X, is in f of u. So we are proving this here, no? Any point here is also here. And that's the end of the proof. Okay. Well, when it's a concentrate, there are many, this is notated from the book. There are many names here, no? So one has always to look, what was 1W? What is V? What is that, no? Maybe too many names, but one has to concentrate. What is our set, okay? Anyway, the proof is not difficult. The main part is the Urizon lemma, okay? To have all these functions, F1, F2. So this is a proof of the Urizon metrization theorem, okay? Well, and now the last theorem is much easier. It's a consequence of this one, anyway. I finish with the following theorem, which is also very nice. Also Urizon metrization theorem. So this is a complete solution. If X compact, suppose X is a compact space, and X is metrizable, if and only if X is metrizable, then, well, anyway, if and only if X has a countable basis. For a compact space, this is a complete solution, okay, of the metrization problem. If X is compact, then metrizability and second countability are equivalent completely, okay? For compact spaces, this is a solution. So here the proof is now easy. That's nice, okay? We don't prove the general metrization theorem, no? We know second countable in general is not sufficient, okay? It's not necessary, okay? First countable, it's between first and second countable, no? The general metrization. Well, the proof is we have two directions. The interesting is, this one. So X has a countable basis. This is Urizon metrization. So compact implies normal, okay? X compact, that you have to be proved, implies X is normal anyway. And if X is normal and second countable, then X is metrizable. And this is the Urizon metrization theorem, okay, which we proved. Normal, second countable, X is metrizable. So this is a corollary, X metrizable. This is Urizon metrization theorem, okay? So the other direction is also interesting because this is one of our exercises, which I like. So what now? X is metrizable, compact, okay? X compact metrizable. So exercise. X metrizable, compact. Implies what we have to prove, X is second countable, okay? X has a countable basis.
This is the easy direction.
Do you remember this exercise, okay? So there are two exercises. One we did already. This is if X is metrizable and has a countable dense subset, then it is at a countable basis. That's what we did. And this is the second of this. If it's now it's metrizable and compact, then it has also a countable basis.
X is compact, then X is normal.
What? Say again, I didn't.
The first direction.
So if X is compact, compact space is normal, right? A compact Hausdorff of case, okay? Is that what you mean? Compact Hausdorff. Oh, sorry, sorry. There's something wrong, right? Compact Hausdorff. Yes. Well, very often compact includes Hausdorff, but not with us, okay? So I forgot that. Of course, Hausdorff we need, okay? Yeah, okay. Compact Hausdorff. We need a compact Hausdorff space, okay? If it's not Hausdorff, it's not metrizable, right? So that's certainly the first necessary condition for being metrizable, okay? So we need a Hausdorff space, yes. Thanks. Compact Hausdorff means normal, right? And then normal second countable implies metrizable, yeah, okay. And this is our exercise, right? I hope you remember that, okay? Yes. So what is the idea? So proof? Well, let's do it as an exercise, proof. This was the exercise. It's the exercise in the book. So metrizable compact. So let Bn be a finite covering of what is X by open balls of radius n. Okay. 1 over n, 1 over n. By open balls of radius 1 over n. This exists now because it's compact. You take all open balls of radius 1 over n. This is an open covering, so you have a finite subcovering, okay? So no problem. And let B be the union over all of these Bn, n in n. This was a hint in the exercise, right? This was a hint. Let B be the, so B is countable, okay? This is clearly countable. Even a countable covering would be okay still for countable, right? Well, anyway. So B is the basis, okay? Now we have to prove that B is the basis. B is the basis for the topology of X. So what means basis? So now it's okay, okay? This is the isometrization, the second. Compact Hausdorff space. So what means B is a basis? This means that if you have an open set U open, if you have a point X in U, you should be able to find a basis element which contains X and is contained in U. Then a lemma says this is a basis, okay, for the topology. So we have this situation again. However, X is metric space, metrizable, okay. So what we find is, I make my picture. We find a ball okay, which contains the center x and contained in u. So this is the ball dx for some n, no? 1 over n. Epsilon. And then I take some 1 over n immediately, okay? 1 over n. Now we want to find our basis element. So what we do, what I do is, I consider half the radius again, okay? Half the radius. 1 over 2n. No, no, sorry. One second. I apply for 2n this, okay? So I have an open covering of balls of radius 1 over 2n now, okay? So this is our n, okay? And now I pass to 2n. So let x, it's 1 over 2n, they cover. Finitely many, but they cover, okay? Let x be b, d. So now I find another point, which is called, whatever it is called, y, radius 1 over 2n. And this in b, in so this is in b, how do you call this? 2n, no, b2n, one of these. So contained in b. So I consider these balls, okay? N is this one. So here's some, so it's in this, obviously, but it's somewhere, this is 1 over 2n, so the point Z, Y, what is it, Y, is here, okay? Half the radius, somewhere here. And now we have this ball here, okay? This is this ball. Y 1 over 2n, which contains x, okay? This contains x. So what we need, it's contained in this one, which is clear from the picture. And then it's contained in u, and then we are done, okay? So the point is that B, D, Y, 1 over 2n, however, is contained in this one, BD x 1 over n. Why z? Well, you take any point here, okay, z. So take any point here, where? In the, this one, z, okay. Then the distance of z and x, okay, you have triangular inequality. So this implies that the distance of x and z, since the distance of x is smaller or equal to what? This is 1 over 2n, and this is also 1 over 2n, okay? 1 over 2n plus 1 over 2n. So 1 over n. You need smaller. Okay, and that's it. So we have this. So this is a lemma, okay? This is the exercise, okay? This is the proof of the exercise. Okay. That finishes the general topology part. And now we start immediately with, so the nicest theorems obviously are lemma of Urizon, Urizon metrization, and this second Urizon, okay? By the way, I looked, so So Urizon was from 1898 to 1924. And the general metrization theorem, he proved in 24 all this stuff, okay? Is there are three names, or two, three names. By so one is Nagata, Japanese, independently, okay, Smirnov. And Bing also has some version. They all have some version, okay. So there are two, three groups of people who independently proved the general metrization, which I didn't tell you, okay? We have to find a condition between first and second counter, okay? Normal, okay. Normal we need anyway, okay? But we need something between first and second counter. And this was quite subtle. So this was from more or less from 1950. Okay, proved 1950. So that means it took 25 years to find this condition, okay? After Urizon, it took another 25 years, no, to find the right condition, which is subtle, okay? You can have a look in the book, what is the condition? Some existence of special kind of basis between first and second counter. Okay, so this is also historically, it's quite interesting, okay? Okay. Maybe he died with 26 years now. Maybe if he would have gone on doing mathematics, maybe this would be, I don't know, when he obviously would have also thought about that, okay, after this, after his first paper, and then maybe we have 1935 or something, but that's, of course, history. Okay. So now it's good. So this we can forget not everything, but almost everything. No, something we need. But homotopy and fundamental group. The first part will be very formal, okay, and maybe a little bit boring. But the second part, then we have applications, and that is very interesting again. But the first part is formal, okay? So I have many definitions. So definition, what is homotopy? To continuous maps, F and F prime from X to Y are homotopic. And we write that F is homotopic to F prime. So this is the notion, homotopic. Not isomorphism, okay? Homotopy is one, just one of these. If there exists a continuous function map and function is the same always. Capital F from X cross I is the interval 0, 1, so this is interval 0, 1 as usual, 0, 1, closed interval, to Y such that F at time, so this is a time interval, F at time 0 is F of X, and at time 1, F of x1 is f, f prime of x. So f is called a homotopy. Between f and f prime. And then sometimes we write also f homotopic to f prime, and we by a homotopy f, okay? F is a homotopy. What is a homotopy? Homotopy is a continuous deformation from f to f prime, okay? So a continuous deformation. From f to f prime. That's intuitively what f, what a homotopy is, okay? You can deform continuously this map f to a map f prime. That's the definition of homotopy. Example. First of all, this is a equivalence relation, so homotopy, so observation. Remark, homotopy is an equivalence relation on the set of continuous maps from X to Y. What is equivalence relation? So F, the first is F is homotopic to F, no? By constant homotopy, okay? By the constant homotopy. So the constant homotopy means f of xt is constant, is f of x. Constant does not depend on the time, okay? So this is trivial. The second, what is the second? So f homotopic to g f prime. By homotopy f implies that G is homotopic to F by a homotopy G. And how do you define G? G of XT is equal to F of X. Yeah. You just reverse the time. From 0, 1, you go from 1 to 0. Okay? So this is the second one. And the third one is if X, F is homotopic to G, by a homotopy f. And g is homotopic to fg, what is the next, h, no? By a homotopy g, then we have to define a homotopy from f to h. H, okay? So then you can think how to define h. So how do you define h? So what you have is we have f from, we have f which go, so this is my kind of picture which I will use, okay? Here we have f. Here we have g. And here's the homotopy between f and g, which is called f, right? This is the kind of notation, f, g, homotopy, f. So this is a picture of X cross I, okay? This is a time interval here on this side. And then we have a homotopy from G to H. And this is called G. So it's defined here, okay? This again is a time interval, okay? So we have to put it together. in a good way. So h of xt is equal to so between 0 and 1 half, we take f of x 2t, no? And between x of, between 1 half and 1, we take the other one, which is g of x, and now 2t minus 1, yes. H is continuous. Why? By the pasting lemma. We have on two parts it's continuous, and then, okay. So you have this lemma, pasting lemma. Okay. So it's an equivalence relation. Examples. First, every map from FX, every map, a continuous map, of course, F from X to Rn, let's take Rn here, standard Rn, analysis Rn. Every continuous map, F from X to Rn, is homotopic to a constant map. So let's see this. This means it's not very interesting. Seen from point of view of homotopy, maps to Rn are not interesting, okay? They're all homotopic to constant maps, which are trivial, you know, the trivial maps. So let's see this. So we have to find a homotopy from F to a constant map. So we have we have f of x which constant? Well, I don't care, x zero, okay? No. Here we have an Rn. This is an Rn, right? F of x and some constant, 0. But it doesn't depend on the constant. So I call this z0. Okay? And now we just move f of x for each x continuously to this point. So what is the homotopy? So f is homotopic to the constant map. I write this way, in z0, okay? This is a constant map. In the point z0, so we are in Rn here. It's a constant map, okay? And so this homotopy. So what is the homotopy? H of xt is equal to, so this one, okay? So at time, whatever, at time 0, we want f of x. F of x at time 0. So 1 minus t. That's good, no? At t equals 0, we have f of x, okay? And at time 1, we want z0. So plus t. That's it, okay. So now at time one we have constant, okay? At time one is constant. So what is this? This is a line, no? This is a segment. So we just go on the segment. This works only in Rn, okay? In arbitrary spaces, we don't know how to do something like this. So this is called straight line homotopy, okay? Because it follows straight line, okay? Straight line homotopy. So we will use this. This is a straight line homotopy. In Rn. Only in Rn. In arbitrary spaces, we don't know what is a straight line, right? So we have a vector space. We have, okay, with a sum in Rn is a vector space. So this is a straight line homotopy. Second example. So take a path, f from 0, 1 to x. Path is continuous map, okay? Take any path. So this means then f is homotopic to constant path. Again, not very interesting. Why is this? Well, it's almost as trivial, the same as this, no? So we have homotopy, hxt. So what do you take? F of x is bad now, okay? Because this seems we are here. Sorry, okay? X is bad. X is the image now, okay? So I take it st, okay? This is better, st. So what you take, well, it depends where you want the constant, okay? You can take any point, but the first point, let's take the first point. So then I have to write s times, let me try, 1 minus t. So if t is equal to 0, we have f. Okay, if t is equal to 0, we have f. If t is equal to 1, we have f constant in the end point, okay? That I don't want. I want on the initial point. So what is s? T times s. Well, sorry. 1, I wrote 1, let me try, 1 minus t times s. So if t is 0, we have f. If t is 1, we have f of 0, the initial point. Okay, yeah. So the constant map in the initial point, okay? This is a constant map. In the initial point, f of 0. In some sense, you see the homotopy, okay? It's clear what is this homotopy. It looks like this. So here the picture is this. Now you have this and you have some f. Okay? And now you have this homotopy. What happens in the homotopy? Well, multiply with, intuitively, this homotopy is at time 1/2. You just go to half of this, okay? Between 0 and 1, reparameterize. And then at time 3 over 4, you just go to this point, okay? And then finally, at time 0, you stay all the time in this point, okay? So you see, so in time 0, you go all the way, okay? In time 1/2, you go half the way, half velocity, okay? Or maybe you stay here. You gave it the same velocity, and then you remain here, okay? At time 3 over 4, you go just to this point, 1 over 4, and stay there. And at time 1, finally, you stay all the time in this point, okay? So the one homotopy is this one, okay? This means this is not interesting for passes also, okay? So we have to, but we want, so what we do now, this we don't want, okay, for passes. The general definition of homotopy is what I gave, okay? For passes, I have to modify now, okay? Why? Because this is not interesting otherwise, okay? Every path otherwise would be homotopic to a constant path, and constant paths are trivial paths, no, not interesting paths. Okay? So now modification. Modification of the notion of homotopy. For paths, only for paths. Okay, only for paths. What we do, we fix this point and we fix the endpoint. Okay? We are not allowed to move these two points. So in some sense, we fix it here, we fix it here by some nail, and then we can move in between what we want by a continuous deformation. Okay? But these two points, we are not allowed to move, okay? So we cannot go back to the initial point, okay, with everything. So definition. And this is the definition of path homotopy. Okay. That means, of course, that the two paths, if we fix these points, the two paths have, we need the same initial and the same endpoint. Otherwise, we cannot compare, okay? Right? So let f and g from the interval to x be paths with the same initial point. So what is this? F of 0 equal g of 0. And the same endpoint. F of 1 equal g of 1. So we have this picture then, no? We have F and we have g going. Then f and g are, well, path homotopic, but I will not use, for paths, the homotopy is this definition, okay? So it's path, but we say just homotopic. F and g are homotopic as paths if there exists, there is a continuous map, capital F, from, now we have I cross I, the time interval, to x such that so as before, F, capital F of, now I have to write S now because X is not good. At time 0, we have F. At time 1, we have the other one, G. So these two means homotopy in the general sense, okay? That is homotopy. Homotopy in the general sense. But not for paths, this is not sufficient. So now we add F of 0, this is the initial point. T, we always have the point F of 0, which is also G of 0. Okay. And at the end point, F of 1, T, we always have F of 1. These points we are not allowed to move. G of 1. And so this all together, this is path homotopy. Okay. So the picture looks like this. And I will use these pictures, which is very... So down we have f, here we have g, two passes, and here we have the constant, okay, in the point f of 0, which is also the point g of 0. And on this, we have the constant in the point f of 1, which has to be also the point g of 1. And here we have our homotopy. And we write, again, f is homotopic to g. And in the book, I forgot, he uses some other sign, which I'm not use. I forgot which sign even, okay? He uses something like this, or p, or pass homotopy, okay? I will not use this, okay? So I just write this, okay? Also for pass homotopy. If f and g are paths, this is always path homotopy. Okay, so this is the definition of path homotopy. So again, the same remark as before. This is an equivalence relation, but where? So a remark, path homotopy. It's an equivalence relation. On the set of passes from a fixed initial point x0 to a fixed endpoint x1. Okay? These two we have. From a fixed initial point, from the on the set of passes in X, of course, or space, from a fixed initial point x0 in X to a fixed endpoint x1 in X. And the proof is the same as before, okay? You just check also that everything goes well. I mean, if it's constant here on both, then also the map which you defined before is constant on this, okay? No problem. So this is a path homotopy, okay? Homotopy, important notion in general, okay? Homotopy, path homotopy for passes. Because it's not interesting otherwise for passes. Okay. For paths, we have a product. We want to define a group, okay, using paths. A group, and okay, fundamental group. And we need a product. So product of paths, it's a... Another definition. Let f be a path. X is fixed in x from x0, from x0 to x1. And g a path. So of course, if we want the product, the second one has to start where the first one finishes. Now then we have and g a path from x1 to x0, x1, x2. So we have this picture. This is x0, x1, this is f. And then we have g, which goes from x1 to x2. This is g, okay? Then f, first f and then g. That's the product. The product we write in this way. First f, then g. Then fg from y to x. So how is it defined? F times g of, well, no, an s or t, I don't know. No, the t is, let me take s. Okay, the parameter. So it's equal to what? As before, for s between 0 and 1 half, we take the first path, f of 2t. So this is twice velocity, okay? And for s between 1 half and 1, we take g, but also with twice velocity. With double velocity, twice the velocity, okay? Yeah. Okay, now it's okay, yes. So this is a path, which is called a product, is a path. Why is it a path? Again, by the Pacing lemma, no? That's why it has a name, so it's used everywhere here. It's a path, which is called the product. Of f and g. So again, clearly defined only if, let me emphasize again, defined only if f of 1 is equal to g of 0. Then the product is defined. Otherwise, there's no product. Okay? So x0, x1. So this is x1, no, in this situation. Okay. This is the x1 here. Yes. So we have a product now, which is not always defined, but anyway. What we need, we want to define a group, right? What we need associativity, no? And then we need identity element, and we need inverse element, these three things, okay? For this product, we have no chance, okay? Because a path is a path, okay? And if you fix a path, you can go back, okay, but this is not, so we have to pass through homotopy. If you want a group, we have to pass to homotopy, okay? So, definition. For a path, f from x, from I to x, let, so this is on the equivalence class. You always denote like this, no, in general. F be the path equivalence class of F. The equivalence class of F is an equivalence relation. Be the equivalence class of F with respect to path homotopy. This is a familiar notation, right? The equivalence class you very often denote by by these parentheses, okay? Let f be the equivalent. And then a definition, let f and g be paths with, so the condition, f of 1 equals g of 0. Otherwise, there's no product, okay? Now the product is defined. Then we have the definition, define f, now, but now I want to, not passes, but equivalence classes of passes. No, the usual thing, you, so this is the definition, and you take the equivalence class of f times g. Okay, so this is a product of equivalence classes, no, not of passes. Product of equivalence classes of passes. What we have to prove, that is well defined, okay? Which is well defined. The usual thing. Which is well defined. Well defined means does not depend on the choice of representatives. So what we have to prove, if f is homotopic to f prime, so if f is equal to f prime, no, that means f is homotopic to f prime by a homotopy f, right? And g, we have another representative. So this means g is homotopic to g prime by a homotopy g. Then we have to prove that f times g is homotopic to f prime times g prime. Sorry, homotopic to f prime times g prime. Okay? And so this implies then that f times g is whatever it implies. F times g is equal f prime times g prime. Okay? Yes. So we have to define this homotopy here, h. Okay? And now we again a picture, okay? So what we have? We have f, where's f? Homotopy f between f and f prime. And then we have g between g and g prime. And here it's constant, okay? Here's the same point. F of 1 is g of 0. So this is looks good. Now we have just have to go back to our interval. So we define h of st equal to. And now the interval which I have, the parameter which I have to change is s, not t. S, here's the interval. That's okay. That looks anyway good, okay? But here I have to change. So between s, between 0 and 1 half, so what I take here, here I take f of 2s, t. And s between 1 half and 1, I take the other one, g, 2s minus 1, t. Sorry? Now, you say this is a product between f and g? We don't define a product here.
Yeah,
for any fixed t, it is a product of this path and this path. Yeah, but I don't have names for this. So one second. What I want to say now is that then this is this homotopy, okay? At time zero, we get really the product of f and g, okay? So h of what? Of s at time zero. We have this product, so I'm getting tired. So at time zero, we have the product f of f and g. That means for t equals zero, h of st at time zero, this is f times g of s. And at time one, this is f prime times, so then we're here, times g prime of s. By the definition of this product, by definition of h and of this product, okay? We're doing here exactly the same as we did for f and g, okay? By definition, by the definitions of h and the product of two passes. So that's more or less what you, and at the time, in the intermediate time, we have the product of this path and this path, no? Yeah. But I didn't give names, so I don't know. Okay, so again, f is, h is continuous by the Pasting lemma, okay? It's always a Pasting lemma. H is continuous by the Pasting lemma. Well, so the time is finished. So we go on tomorrow. This is homotopy is important concept, of course. Probably you know, I don't know. Homotopy, path homotopy. Then it's natural product of passes, no? And we want to a group now. So tomorrow we define a group. This is very formal. This last second part of today and tomorrow also, okay? The definition of fundamental root is very formal. And then you say, well, many definitions, no? But then the fundamental group is an important concept, okay, in mathematics. So, and then we have very nice, this is the first part here is very formal, but then we have some very nice applications, which are very concrete applications, okay, of fundamental group. So tomorrow we go on with this.